Hello, and welcome to another edition of Interviewing the Legends, brought to you by the Publicity Works Agency, devoted to promoting musicians and authors worldwide. Call us today at 941-877-1552 to start your free publicity evaluation. Remember, we shine only when we make you shine. Please welcome the host of Interviewing the Legends, music journalist, author, and entrepreneur, Ray Shasho.
Hello, once again, everyone. I'm your host, Ray Shasho. Welcome to another edition of Interviewing the Legends on BBS Radio, brought to you by the Publicity Works Agency. Call us today at 941-877-1552 or email us at publicityworksagency.com. Remember, we shine only when we make you shine. And by the Rockstar Chronicles, Series 1. That's my new book, featuring over 45 intimate conversations with the greatest music legends the world will ever know. Available now at bookbaby.com and amazon.com. Well, Deborah Bonham, the immensely talented singer-songwriter, follows up her celebrated 2018 USA Stars Align tour with Paul Rogers, Jeff Beck, and Ann Wilson by signing with USA's Quarto Valley Records. Deborah joins forces with her renowned guitarist husband, Peter Bullock, on a new exciting blues-inspired project named Bonham Bullock. Bonham Bullock is set to release an album in early 2021 on Quarto Valley Records. Over the course of an impressive career, Deborah Bonham, sister of the late John Bonham of Led Zeppelin, has established herself as one of the finest blues, rock, and soul singers the UK has produced. A string of critically acclaimed original album releases, captivating standing ovation concert performances at the Royal Albert Hall, London Palladium, and the previously mentioned Stars Align tour have kept her at the very forefront of the international music scene. Belfast-born guitarist Peter Bullock, lauded by the press for his passionate and exceptional playing, paid his dues playing the clubs and theaters across the UK and Europe for many years, which allowed Peter the chance to express himself as a guitar player. Rory Gallagher and many other guitarists were a big influence on Pete's playing, but it was Paul Kossoff who he connected with the most. Years later, Pete's playing would not go unnoticed by none other than Bad Company's Paul Rogers, who selected Pete and the rest of Deborah's band to back him on a Free Spirit tour of the UK in 2017 and 2018 USA Stars Align. In 2018, Deborah sang and Pete played guitar on Dust My Broom, which was the lead track on the much-talked-about and highly successful Elmore James tribute album, Strange Angels. Strange Angels was produced by Marco Giovanno of Robert Plant's Band of Joy, the album which featured tracks by Tom Jones, Bette Lovette, Kev Moe, Billy Gibbons, Warren Haynes, and much more. Deborah Pete and Quarto Valley Records thought this would be the perfect time for the new joint venture, so get ready for a brilliant new album by Bonham Bullock. Please welcome Deborah Bonham and Pete Bullock to Interviewing the Legends. Hello, guys.
Hi, Ray.
Hi, Ray.
Lovely to be with you.
Lovely to have you here. How did you guys first meet, and when did you know you wanted to marry each other?
Only you, Pete.
Well, in the words of a very famous Northern Irish man that can be heard on a Pink Floyd album, Dark Side of the Moon, that made the phrase, I don't know, I was drunk at the time.
It's funny.
I must have been. I don't know why I'm still here, actually.
That was Henry McCulloch that had those words on Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon.
Was that Henry McCulloch that said that?
Yeah, it still was.
Henry of the Greek band and Frankie Miller's band.
Yeah, I interviewed Henry a long time ago. Bless bless him, you know, bless his soul. He's a really cool guy.
We actually met 30 years ago, believe it or not.
Really?
Honestly, I don't know how come I'm still here. I would have been out of jail by now. we're still together, aren't we?
Sorry, who are you?
You got to that Alzheimer's part yet?
Yes, every day it seems like a one-night stand every day.
That's a good thing.
Yeah. We met at a wedding, Ray. We met at a wedding.
Not our own.
And Pete was the guitarist in the band.
Right.
And
next morning her dad turned up with a big shotgun and said, I don't know you.
But anyway, literally, we met that night and that was it.
And that was it, huh? Your love at first sight.
Yeah, well, it was, yeah. Actually, you know, if I'm really, I'm going to be a bit cheesy now, but it was his guitar playing, because I was as blind as a bat and couldn't see him.
I thought it was because I was pretty.
It was definitely his guitar playing.
That's funny. Yeah, I wonder the same thing about my wife, because her vision was very bad, too. But I didn't...
Can she play the guitar?
I can play the guitar, but not like you.
I thought it was your wife with the guitar.
No, that was me.
Well, that's where we met, and that's it was a friend's wedding 30 years ago this year.
30 years ago, wow.
Yeah, so long time ago. And, and we've been happily married ever since.
Awesome, awesome. You don't hear that too.
Not one fallout on the sofa. Separate hotels. No, nothing like that at all.
That's awesome. But it worked out great, because now you collaborate musically, you know. That really worked out good.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think if you ask any long-standing couple that, you know, are 24/7 touring together, like we've been, I mean, it's not an easy job.
No.
Both parts, really, is it? Because we're both quite sort of...
Well, you probably shouldn't ask Stevie Nicks and Chris Reeves. They got fed up with one member of the band and then went on to another. So.
That's true.
Like that.
No, we don't. But, I mean, we've just, you know, we just got on with it. We just realised that I don't think anybody else would put up with either of us. So that's like sort of...
You're made for each other.
Pardon?
You're made for each other.
Yeah, you know what? I do believe in that and fate, and I think we were, because it sort of worked out.
Either that or we're both last chance to lose.
No, seriously, Pete, no one else will have it. I know, last chance to lose. Oh, okay.
And you're also a comedy team, right? Or you should be. You know what's so cool is, you know, when I do these interviews, the wife is now in charge, you know, of all the bookkeeping, the touring, and booking shows and everything like that. You know, one example would be, oh my gosh, here's what happens when you get old.
Oh, no, it. That's like every night.
I'm a toy boy. I'm younger.
You know, Steve and Joe Hackett. That's who I was thinking about,
yeah,
you know, from Genesis.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, God. He was one of my heroes. Spectral Mornings was one of my favorite albums.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, they work together now, and there's so many wives that have taken over the business now because, you know, they can trust their wife, you know, not all these shady business guys, you know?
Tell him that next time.
It just goes to prove Spinal Tap was way ahead of its time.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we're going to do our album in Dublin, yeah.
I know, yes. Look out for the new album in Dublin, yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to ask a couple of questions. First about Big Brother.
Yeah.
You guys were really years apart. Me and my brother are like 8-9 years apart. He's older than me.
Uh-huh.
But when Zeppelin formed, you were like around 6 years old, right?
Yeah, there was 14 years between John and myself.
14 years, yeah.
Yeah.
So how did you guys ever get a chance to play together, you know, musically or anything like that?
No, not really.
Uh-huh.
What we did do, and what gave me a lot of my musical influence, I did get to see Zeppelin when I was very young, you know, whenever they played the UK, I think I was about 8 and I was at Bath Festival and things like that, and Birmingham Odeon and Town Hall and then Earl's Court and Nebworth and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But I also had moments with him where he'd play me a lot of music.
Oh, cool.
He'd play me an awful lot of all sorts of, he was very much a Motown guy, actually. He loved Motown, he loved the old Motown drummers, he loved the big band stuff,
mm-hmm.
But I very much remember him coming and playing me Hendrix from the Isle of Wight, and he had this big old clunky VHS sort of thing, you know,
right.
Before everybody had VHS recorders and all that. And he got out this huge sort of tape and put it in, and we both sat and watched it. And he said, "You've just got to watch him. You've got to watch him." So I didn't really know who Hendrix was. And so, he coloured my life very much like that. You know, he got me into Little Feat.
Mm-hmm.
He got me into the Spinners, which were they were called the Detroit Spinners at one point. But all of that sort of music he really did get me into.
Yeah, I learned a lot from my brother's collection, because, you know, he grew up, he was in Vietnam, and he grew up during that era and everything, and, you know, I used to listen to his albums. That's how I got into, you know, Hendrix and people, Black Sabbath and bands like that.
I was very privileged in that way to have that much music, you know, because of him and my other brother Michael. They were 2 years apart.
Right.
And so I was able to hear an awful lot of great music from a very, very early age. So, you know, while other kids of my age were listening to David Cassidy and
Bobby Sherman.
I was listening to Joni Mitchell and Crosby, Stills and Nash and the Spinners and Al Green and Otis Redding and stuff. So.
Yep. All my favorites too.
Yeah. And well, you know, he very much, if that's what he loved, and he'd regularly play it. And he'd always, we were a very close family, so he would have, him and my sister-in-law Pat would have weekend parties, you know, with the family.
Right.
And on would go the jukebox. And John had a kit set up in the corner of the room.
Oh,
and
cool.
He'd get on the kit and play.
Mm-hmm.
And he'd go and drag young Jason, and he'd have to come out and play. And he was brilliant. You know, Jason was so, so good. But yeah, it was a privileged upbringing for sure.
Oh, definitely. What was John, was he very protective of you since you were the girl, I guess?
Oh, crikey, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember telling him as I got a bit older, you know, because I went into opera music, really, at school.
Mm.
And I just remember telling him, you know, that I didn't want to do that, and I wanted to do rock and roll. And, gosh, he was really not happy. And I used to sneak off as well from school and get the train to London and go to the Swan Song office, you know, because all the bands were hanging out there. And, oh, I'd be in so much trouble with him. He'd be furious. And I know why now, you know. I would have been worried about my kid sister, you know, in that era. And, you know, that sort of thing. I get it. I totally get why he didn't want me to do it. But, you know, you follow your heart, and that's where my heart was. So, you know, that's what... I mean, the main thing was to try and do him proud, I guess. You know, there's no point trying to, you know, have the name Bonham that he made so famous, and rightly so, and then be rubbish. You know, you've got to really dig deep and do your best. And if it isn't good enough, well, then you've got to just say, okay, it's not good enough. But so far, we've been okay. We've done well.
That's pretty cool, though, that you can say, yeah, my big brother was the greatest drummer in the world. And my nephew is not too bad either.
You know, that one is, sometimes I think about it, and that accolade is so huge.
Yeah.
I think, good grief, that was my brother, you know.
Yeah.
Because at home, he was, you know, he was John, he was my brother, he was, you know, he was, he'd get up, he'd take us all out. We had a lot of fun, you know. So yeah, massive accolade.
Mm-hmm. Did Peter get
in my eyes? Of course he was, you know.
Yeah.
The greatest drummer.
Did Peter ever get to meet him?
No, unfortunately, John had passed by the time I was with Pete.
Right, right.
He appeared 10 years later.
Yeah, that's a shame, huh?
Yeah, because I think they would have got on really well. Same type of humour, same sort of naughty boy glint in their eye. I think Pete might have disappeared into the pub a few times with him.
Oh, know? Definitely.
Yeah. So yeah, it's sort of sad that never happened. But
yeah.
I think he knows everything there is to know about John, having lived with me. So.
Yeah, I was very fortunate to see him play twice. I think back in 74, around that time, and 77, two tours.
Yeah.
One of them was at the Capitol Center, you know, like 20,000-person arena, and I slept outside to get the tickets, and it started raining.
Was that at because the 77 one was Tampa, Florida, wasn't it?
So yeah, Tampa, Florida as well. Yeah, I was in Maryland at the time. I was brought up in the Washington D.C. area, in Maryland and Virginia area.
Huh.
Yeah, but I mean, I got to see him twice. What a drummer! I mean, I remember smoke coming out. You know, I still swear today that his drum set was going in circles and smoke was coming out everywhere. I could have sworn I saw that. But an incredible band, of course, you know.
Well, yeah, and you know, when you grow up with that,
yep.
I mean, you know, 6 years old, and I'm watching Led Zeppelin, and by the time I've got to about eight, I just thought, yeah, I want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'll be easy.
He's a piece of cake.
Yeah, I had some life lessons to learn there. You know?
Well,
but yeah. They were just the most incredible band, and we set an awful lot, you know, the bar's set by them.
Yeah.
You know, I often think with the drums, with the bass, guitar bits, you know, I quite often tap into their music and think what they would do, because they would...
Oh, what would John Paul Jones do there?
Yeah, they take it somewhere else, you know.
They do.
And it's been interesting producing this new album that we've done, because there's a few things where I've just thought, oh yeah, that's possibly what Zep might have done there. Not much, you know, and I don't go out there to try and copy that, or you probably wouldn't even hear it really,
mm-hmm.
But it's just got that energy, you know?
Yeah. Every so often you get a little clue that, you know, there'd be a little sort of nod and a tip of the hat to maybe a little Led Zeppelin arrangement.
Sure.
Not just Led Zeppelin, but most of our other influences, you'll pick out all sorts of people in there.
It's not obvious, but to the well-informed fans, but you'd probably go, oh, that's got that vibe, that
mm-hmm.
feel.
I think we've had people listening to the records and somebody would say something like, hang on, was it? That sounded a bit Neil Young there.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a huge compliment. I mean, a lot of bands are doing that. You can hear... I mean, you know, it's very hard to be 100% original. You're going to pick up styles from all kinds of groups. You can't help it.
I prefer just to call it a guitar stew, really. It's a guitar stew with, you know, a couple of dozen ingredients, you know, which will, you know, include your Paul Kossoff, B.B. King, Rory Gallagher, Hubert Sumlin, even Jimmy Page and
mm-hmm.
Neil Young, and, you know, all those kind of things. It's all in there, isn't it,
Robert thought you sounded a bit Peter Green on the album.
He did. That was,
that's awesome.
I liked that compliment. That was
a
nice
compliment.
Yeah.
So, the whole mood, it sounded very, very like, there's a kind of a greeny sound, and it's a very haunting that came on. So, yeah, oh, that's pretty cool when Robert Plant says that.
That is cool. Now, Deborah, Robert's kind of your mentor, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, I've known him for so long, and he's a very close friend.
Right.
And, you know, he's a trailblazer in music.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The guy just, he never ceases to amaze me, nor Pete for that matter, with how he continually moves through music and genres and, you know, reinvents and does this amazingly new stuff and the production ideas that he does, you know. I listen to him closely. I guess I always have done, really. And he's a real close, you know, he's a very close friend. He's sure. Like a brother, really. You know, to me and Pete, he's very close with Pete.
Hmm.
Well, Robert and John were incredibly close, so that, you know, I think John.
Well, we got, our relationship went to a sort of another level when we did the memorial for John, didn't we?
Right.
Yeah, we spent about 3 or 4 years together, building a memorial statue for John Bonham at his hometown of Redditch.
Mm-hmm.
So it was Deborah, myself, Robert Plant, and Robert's sound engineer, Roy Williams, who sadly passed this year.
Mm.
So the little team of four of us were visiting the sculptors and seeing it through and deciding, you know, what would be cool and tasteful and all that kind of stuff. So it was an incredible period of time. And the actual finished project was just amazing.
We put it up on John's 70th, didn't we? At that midnight on the 30th of May.
Mm-hmm.
The birthday's the 31st. So on the 30th of May, without any press or anybody there, we didn't quite. We just wanted it to appear, you know, in true Zeppelin mystique. So a few of us got together and we put it up through the night, and then of course the next day people were walking through the town of Redditch, and all of a sudden there it was with "Happy Birthday, John" all over it.
It had to actually turn up on a 40-foot lorry and a huge big crane, because
mm-hmm.
it weighed about 5 tons of bronze. So it was quite a task to secretly install this in a town centre.
I can imagine.
It was amazing.
Yeah.
And through doing that, we raised an awful lot of money for Teenage Cancer Trust.
Oh, fantastic. Fantastic, yeah.
That's sort of written into the bronze on the back. So,
right.
You know, if you ever get the chance to go to Redditch in Worcestershire mm-hmm. in the Midlands, and you see this bronze of John, it's John in full flight on his drum kit.
Right.
It was sculpted by this amazing guy, Mark Richards, absolutely unbelievable sculptor that he is. and we tied it in with Teenage Cancer Trust to provide
mm-hmm.
nurses across the Midlands, outreach nurses, in John's name.
Mm-hmm.
So that worked out really, really well. So, yeah, that was our project that we did.
Well, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Thank you both for doing that. That's wonderful. My wife's a retired nurse, and she she's done it all, and she's also done cancer care and all kinds of stuff. She worked at cancer center. And,
well, myself, Pete, and Robert and Roy visited the Birmingham Hospital for the teenage cancer
mm-hmm.
stuff and saw the kids in there, and really, you know. You come away, I mean, I don't know whether to say inspiring is the right word, but it was. Although it was devastatingly harrowing, these kids were really fighting it, you know. And the great thing about Teenage Cancer Trust that was Roger Daltrey set up, and it gives kids a chance to be teenagers
mm-hmm.
in a ward instead of, you know, it being all about the cancer. And the difference that makes, it was a real cool ward, you know, all painted great colours and
nice.
A jukebox in there,
yeah.
And a music room and all of that.
Fantastic, yeah.
Yeah, so it was fantastic to be a part of all that, really was. And for John, you know, it was a great legacy for John.
Exactly, yeah. That's so heartbreaking. I don't like to see any child sick. It breaks my heart. I have 5 grandchildren, and, you know, they're all young, so it's, you know, it hits home when you see things like that. It really does.
It does, and you realize that, you know, life's precious, and you just got to get out there and do your best, really.
Yeah, it's short, isn't it? Life is so short. Oh, man. Seems like yesterday.
It's going to be long enough.
Yeah.
You to enjoy it all.
Exactly. But you played with a lot of people. I mean, is it true? Did you actually play with Lonnie Donegan at one time?
Yes.
Really?
I did. That was crazy.
Wow.
I don't know how Lonnie. How did How did Lonnie get that album?
I don't know. Lonnie Donegan got hold of Deborah's album at the time, The Old Eyes, it was called, 2001, and he said, I want that girl to open up for me on the tour. So they got in touch with us, and we thought it was a very strange mix, you know, what's mm-hmm. the Lonnie Donegan, because we were a bit heavier blues and rock. But so we turned it down, thinking we weren't a good fit for it, and he was on the phone personally.
Wow.
He said, no, you don't understand, I want you on this tour. Man,
he's a real sort of cockney as well. He's like, listen, girl, I want you to come and do it. I thought, oh my goodness, it's Lonnie Donegan.
He's a very funny, cheeky chappy.
And John was, you know, he was a hero of John's. When John was growing up,
sure.
Lonnie Donegan was the one that broke down, you know, all the rules. So John was a big fan of Lonnie's. So that kept running through my mind, you know. So we went out and
took the UK with him for a couple of months. It was great.
That's wonderful.
He was a cheeky chap, wasn't he? He was a lovely guy. And then, sadly, he passed away. But his son, who's a chip off the old block, he told us, he rang up and said that the only CD he'd got next to his bed was my mine.
Aww.
To my eyes.
Aww.
Yeah, it was very good. But Pete's just done a Lonnie tribute last year, didn't you?
Yeah, they invited me down to in Cadogan Hall in London with a sort of stellar cast of musicians paying tribute to Lonnie Donegan. So there was Van Morrison, Joe Brown, crikey, Leo Sayer was there. A whole lot of them. Can't remember all the others, but
you were there, Pete. That's the main one. You were there.
But it comes to the last song of the show, and they do "Goodnight, Irene," which is a famous closing song for Lonnie Donegan.
Mm-hmm.
And Van Morrison was singing it, so they came and asked me, said, "Pete, would you do the last show with Van Morrison, please?" And I went, "Oh, let me think about it. I mean, I'm from Belfast as well as Van Morrison,
right?
And we've." We've probably been in the same room a few times, and he's never spoken to me. Well, actually, he did once. He told me to F off. But I was 16. So this is about 40 years later. I'm on stage with him playing the lead break on "Goodnight, Irene."
Oh,
and
man.
I just started doing this guitar solo and looked around at him, and he's looking at me, and I could see this look in his eyes going, "Who the F is that?" And I was looking at him going, "If only you knew." Anyway, I did that, and we finished the song and walked off to our separate dressing room. Still never spoke. But he's a great hero.
I'm sure Lonnie would have thought it was brilliant.
Exactly.
What I do know about Van Morrison, he is famous for these grumpy little stories. What I do know is that he's a dear, dear, to his friends and his family and his band,
mm-hmm.
He is an absolute loyal, dear, dear friend to them. So,
and he hung around all day there, didn't he?
Yeah.
Not many would have done that.
Yeah, he helps a lot of people out, so,
And it was all in aid of Lonnie's grandchild, who is...
Special needs.
Really? Yeah.
Special help.
Yeah, they raised a bunch of money for his private schooling and stuff, so...
Right.
His care.
Well, you...
Yeah, being with Lonnie was a complete trip.
He's influenced so many people, you know.
Absolutely. But as I said, you know, definitely John.
Mm-hmm.
And so to actually be there, and the stories the guy told, I mean, every night he would just be so full of all these different stories. And he was very, very, very giving to us, mm-hmm. you know. Really took care of us.
One of the Lonnie Donegan tribute concerts we were doing was a couple of weeks after, at the end of the Paul Rogers tour, was on, so on the
right.
Paul Rogers tour bus, and I said, you sort of say, what are we up to whenever the tour finishes? I said, well, I've got to go to London and do this Lonnie Donegan tribute night. And so for the next hour or so on the tour bus, Paul Rogers sang every Lonnie Donegan song he knew.
Huh. Really? It had to be a lot of fun.
Oh, what goes on the tour bus stays on the tour bus.
That's funny. So, some other people I want to mention that you toured, well, Foreigner, but, you know, I just had Rick Wills on the show. You know Rick, the bass player?
We both know Rick very well.
And of course, he was in Bad Company, and you know, my favorite album is the first David Gilmour solo album, which he was good friends with. David Gilmour was at his wedding.
Yeah.
But, you know, Rick lives here.
He's a lovely guy. We know him well.
Well,
he's moved to Florida now, hasn't he?
He lives about a few minutes away from me, actually.
Yeah, he used to live about half an hour from us in South England.
How about that?
Yeah.
You're going to have to come visit him.
Yeah, sure, with him. We do these annual sort of animal sanctuary charity concerts.
Right.
And Rick would come along and play with his band that he had with Kenny Jones and Zach Starkey and stuff, and we put on these nights, raise a bit of money, and now he's great.
Rick Donovan?
Donovan was there with us as well. That was a thrill. He's a legend, isn't he?
Yes, he is. Well, Rick, you know what Rick does now? He belongs to a boat club, and you know where they share a boat, and he loves going out on the water now. That's his new thing.
Well, that's the place to do it. Where you are.
Well, you mentioned golf in Florida earlier on, didn't you? He likes a bit of that.
Yes, he does. Yeah, I'm going to get together with him. I'm going to invite him for dinner. I told him after the interview that I was definitely going to do that. We're Facebook friends.
Here's a quick little Florida story. We toured with Florida, but it was long after Rick had left. But,
right.
When we got back to England on the tour, we did the London show. We spoke to Mick Jones while we were on the tour. And said, you know, we do some shows with Rick Wills and all that kind of stuff. He says, oh, would you call him and bring him along to the London show? So we called Rick and invited him along to the London show. And Mick Jones got him up to play a couple of songs for Foreigner again. And that was the first time they played together in God knows how many years.
Yeah.
That was almost like a tearful moment for them all, having a little reunite on stage for us all.
I've had Lou Gramm on the show too. He's a nice guy, really nice guy.
Well, we had a
voice.
Yeah.
Had a fantastic tour with them, you know. So it was, and of course Jason was in the band. So
and Jason was on drums, which probably helped why we got the gig.
I've also had Alana Miles on the show, and you know she dated Robert Plant for I don't know a year or so, I guess. But she's I really like Alana. We had a nice conversation together, and you I think you were on tour with her or something, right? With Alana.
Yeah, I did a show with her.
Okay.
We became pretty good friends.
Right.
I did a show with her. It was a big show actually. It was at the NEC in Birmingham. It was I think Rod Stewart and Diana Ross and goodness knows.
Oh wow, what a show!
I got up with her to sing Black Velvet.
Yeah, that's a great song.
She was lovely. I first saw her opening up for on Robert's tour, and I think she just got Black Velvet going then, you know. But we sort of lost touch, you know, because she went back to Canada, and then, you know, our life moves on, and we lost touch. So, I must send her my love and try and figure out how to get in touch with her again.
Yeah, well, I think I probably have her email if you want me to give it to you.
Cool. Maybe not over the air, but...
No, yeah.
Privately.
She had a great guitarist, Kurt Schechter.
Right.
On that Black Velvet song.
That's a great song.
Yeah. Yeah, and while they were over in England supporting Robert Plant, this is before I met Debbie, then, so she was sort of hanging about with Alana Miles, but Kurt Schechter, for some reason, was hanging around with our bar band in London, because we'd like a drink and a gig and stuff, so he'd come along. And he was there for some of the Deborah Bonham fans that are familiar with my Gibson Les Paul, which I've had for about 35 years.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of a wood finish, but it started off as a Black Beauty custom.
Right.
Les Paul.
Right.
But the reason it's wood finish and stained orange now is because one night with Kurt Schechter at the Hippodrome in London, we got a little bit too excited, and at the last song of the gig, we covered the guitars with lighter fluid and set them on fire. And walked off stage with our bottles of Jack Daniels. And the next morning, we saw the damage we'd done.
Oh, jeez.
The guitar's no longer black.
Oh, my goodness.
And that was with a lot of Miles' guitarist, Kurt Schechter.
Yeah. Listening to way too much Jimi Hendrix, I guess.
I don't think so.
Well, let's talk about the new album. I'm excited about it. It, you know, I was hoping it was out already, but not till what, the beginning of 2021? Any, what's the target date?
I think
it's February, March.
Okay.
It's going to be towards the end of February, beginning of March.
Okay.
Nobody quite knew how this COVID thing was going to play out. So we thought, look, let's hold on to it.
Right.
Tour. We had such a great response. Pete certainly playing with Paul Rodgers on the Stars Aligned tour, you know, and I was opening up, just me and a friend of mine on guitar.
Right.
Ian Hatton, who actually played with Jason in a band called Bonham, so it was the connection was already there. So and he played with Paul Rodgers as well. So we went and opened up for them, and there was Jeff Beck and Wilson, and
it was like one big guitar swapping party.
That's incredible.
But we had such
a keys in the fruit dish, and the two of us.
We had such a great response.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the thing was to come back to the States and tour.
Yes.
And so with this new album, but of course then COVID hit and no one knew quite what was going to happen.
Between that, we did get back to the States and we did New York cutting room.
Yeah, we did. But, you know, our idea was to hold on to we didn't have the album then, but the idea was to hold on to the new album, to release a new album and tour.
Sure.
Of course, that's not going to happen with COVID as it is. So once since this year has sort of played out and everybody's sort of realizing, well, listen, we've got to rethink, because I think we all thought, you know, it would either disappear or there'd be a vaccine quickly, and it hasn't quite worked like that globally. Mm-hmm. So we're just thinking, you know what, let's just get the album out.
Sure.
And then hopefully towards the end of next year, God willing, if there's a vaccine or there's new ways of doing things, we'll be able to come out and tour. So, I think we're talking sort of the end of February, beginning of March, aren't we?
Yeah, I think that was a smart idea. You know, a lot of people have released their new albums, even though I think they just didn't want to wait any longer, you know. But
what happened, Ray. I think everybody initially held back, thinking, oh, and then it was like, oh, well, we're all holding stuff back far too long.
Right.
Everybody will have forgotten about everybody by the time you do it.
Exactly.
I think, you know, we need music.
Exactly.
We can't put out new music. We need it. We need people to hear music. If we can't quite at the moment tour as we know it, I mean, there might be other ways. I know Joe Bonamassa's just done a great gig online, you know, a virtual one.
Right.
Where he's hired the venue and done it all COVID safely, you know. So it might be things like that. You know, who knows? It's not quite like having the audience and having a great, you know, I mean, that's the energy, isn't it? But we just thought, let's just put this record out and see where it goes and see what happens.
So what kind of music, can you explain a little bit about what's going to be on the album? What are we looking at here?
Well, it's the first time that we've done a covers album, really, but they're skill covers, most of them.
Okay.
And it was born out of a few years of chatting and just talking about different songs and stuff with Robert and with Roy, who Pete mentioned, Roy Williams, who was tour manager and front of house sound for Robert, and with our manager Gary Nesbitt as well. It was just about talking about different songs and, oh, you'd do that well. Oh, somebody would say, you'd do that well. And I thought, we've got to a point where Pete and I wanted to do a joint project, you know. I just wanted to take it up a notch from where I was.
Right.
And involve him, and especially since he'd been playing with Paul, he really came out, and I just thought, yeah, let's do something together. That's sort of how it came about, wasn't it?
Sort of, yeah. Well, we've been doing it together, but...
Well, anyway. are we gonna have an on-radio argument?
And here's another thing that annoys me.
Just remember, the wives are always right. The wives are in charge.
That's right.
Hey, you said it, Ray. Why is there in charge?
Yeah, that's just a great bunch of songs, and we just our interpretation of them. most of them are probably not a lot of people have heard them before. So.
Oh, good.
There is the bluesy, I mean, there's a Sam Cooke song on there.
Oh, awesome.
You know, which we've really taken our complete own interpretation of it. And every song we've just changed it around and done stuff. Not only because the originals are the greatest. So you've got to try and bring something else to it, you know. You've got to put your stamp on it.
Sure.
We wanted it to be bluesy, but it's sort of gone bluesy, but with quite a hint of soul and even...
Yeah.
Love it.
Even a smudge of, like, prog.
Ooh.
I mentioned Steve Hackett earlier, so... And Dave Gilmore, so there'll be hints of a bit of Dave Gilmore and Steve Hackett in there for the progier side of things. But you know, we've got things like an Albert King song. You know,
mm-hmm.
I've got to say one of my coolest memories of Albert King is playing a flying V while smoking a pipe.
That's different.
Yeah, and it's like nothing looks so good. Nothing looks so cool as Albert King smoking a pipe playing a lead
driver. And it's just songs that people have said to us, you know, that'd be a good song for you. And there's a song, there's an Ann Peebles song on there as well. And when I first decided I was going to sing properly, Robert gave me an album, which was Ann Peebles, the Can't Stand the Rain album, and he said, have a listen to her, this is what it's all about. And then years later, we ended up working with Ann, didn't we?
Yeah.
And her keyboard player, who's on this album, Paul Brown,
he's also in
the Waterboys, yeah, but he's been with Bobby Rush, and he's an amazing Hammond player. You know, this song just seemed an obvious one to do. So it's sort of they've all got a reason why we've done them. There's a Johnny Taylor song, I Had a Dream, which has very similar to I'm Gonna Crawl, you know, the Led Zeppelin song. You can hear how they got to where they were going from these old songs.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
So yeah, it's
a bit of Stephen Stills in there.
All right.
Yeah, there's quite a bit. So it's exciting. It's the first time I've ever done an album of covers, and it's the first time I've produced. So yeah,
I'm excited.
Do anything I told him to do.
I'm excited. I love covers. I love covers.
It's terrible. I find this new sort of mojo called Thinking for Yourself.
that
idea got beaten out of me.
Well, I gotta say, Deborah, you're
listen, you're like, turn up, have a beer, put his guitar on, throw his head back, play his solos, and go to the pub. You know, he's doing all the work.
Smoke
so
a pipe.
Not getting any money from it at all. I'm not giving him a penny.
You guys are funny. You should have a reality show. Well, I got that.
This is reality, isn't it? Yeah.
This is reality. Yeah.
What I'm impressed with so far is we haven't sworn yet.
I know that's been good.
Yeah.
Well done. We're on radio.
It is part of my national language being from Ireland. To at least have every third word being.
Even got my mother to do it. Can you believe it? John never ever swore in front of my mom.
Really?
Ever.
Really?
He only said crap once, and she really told me not. Sport, because mom moved in with Pete and myself. She lived with us for 20 years.
Yep. My dad lives with me, so.
There you go. So mom moved in with us, and it became Pete's sport to get her to swear. And first of all, it was before lunchtime, then it was before 10 o'clock, then it was before 8 o'clock in the morning if they were up that early. And he'd get it all the time. The one about the milk was the funniest. Say it?
Yeah.
And I'm swearing.
I said that, Joe. I went to the fridge to make a cup in the morning, and of course the fridge was bare, so I said, Joe, how many F's in milk? There's no F in I said, exactly, can you go and get something?
Oh, she used to get so mad with him.
That's funny.
But yeah, so there you go. That's getting back to the album. That's why we just decided to do it this way, and I'm absolutely thrilled with it, actually. I can't wait for it to come out.
Me too.
I think that was another thing as well, wasn't it? Because when you put that much work in, mm-hmm. and then it drags on and on, you're like, oh, you know, it's so new, and you just want it out there.
Right.
So, yeah. So it will be out next year.
That'd be awesome. Deborah, I gotta tell you, you're a fantastic singer. I love your voice. And Peter, you're a great guitar player, man. You guys are a perfect couple, you know?
Oh. I don't know about the perfect. Thank you very much for the compliment. That's lovely.
Well, thank you. Christine McVie was actually called Christine Perfect, wasn't she?
Yeah, she grew up in the road next to where we were in Redditch.
Oh, really?
The name of Peter Perfect now, because Ray Shasher says that.
There you go.
Oh, Lordy, look what you started, Ray.
Yeah, was there a Peter Perfect? Was he in the Wacky Races?
The Wacky Races?
No idea. Anyway.
You know, yeah, when I think of the Irish, I always think of Peter O'Toole and Richard Harris together. You know, they always had the great drinking stories. You know.
Oh, that was in a bar near where we used to live in London.
Really?
Yeah, we bumped into them occasionally. Didn't get to drink with them. I was two in awe.
Well, it's a good thing.
Like, you know, proper legends. They were.
Yes, they were. It's a good thing you didn't drink with them.
He drank with everybody else, right? No, he's not sure the people he's drunk with or been drunk with.
You could write a book.
Yeah. You certainly could.
Well, I can't wait. I can't wait for the new album to come out. I'm really excited. And yeah. I want to tell you, Deborah, my favorite song that you've ever done was Love You So.
That is definitely
my favorite so far. I love that song and the way you sing it.
Thank you. Well, it
comes on the Duchess album. Yeah, that album was out in America in the Eagle about 12 years ago, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Warner Brothers put that out, the Duchess album.
Yeah, something like that.
That's a great.
Yeah, we just. I mean, you know, the bottom line is we want to get this out and get over there and start enjoying what we do, you know.
That's right.
In fact, that song you mentioned, Ray, that's got Jerry Shirley from Humble Pie
exactly.
on that album on drums.
Yep.
Oh yeah, Jerry.
Yeah.
That was a strange one because I've always been a huge Humble Pie fan, and he rang up that one morning, didn't he? You sent him a CD.
Yeah.
Of me singing Black Coffee.
Yeah, because we did Steve Marriott Memorial Concert.
Mm. I love Steve Marriott. Yeah.
And he loved singing, so he asked if he could join our band.
I know. That was a moment.
But Humble Pie got back together again just for that one night. And, of course, after that night was over, you know, Peter Frampton went back to America and everybody went back about their business. And Jerry was left there. He was like all rehearsed up in top drumming form and no band. So he said, well, we need a drummer.
But it was brilliant because we got to do, we did a couple of big festivals in Austria for the Harley-Davidson
right.
people. Which was fantastic, and I said to Jerry, "Well, why don't we do some Humble Pie anyway in the set?"
So that'd be great.
We did a few. I Don't Need No Doctor.
Oh, I love that song.
A couple of others, and just even singing them and Pete playing them.
Yeah.
I mean, we were like all our Christmases at once, you know. And then you turn around and Jerry Shirley's behind you. It was that was fantastic.
I'm going to mention something to my audience here. Some of the great songs that you have done. Take Me Down, which, you know, it's a very nice twist, very country-like, right?
Uh-huh.
Another great tune. I really, really like that. I guess that was from the Spirit album?
Yes, it was. That
was actually, Jenny had written that quite a few years before, because there was going to be a movie about Fleetwood Mac, and our manager at the time said, but I think, Jenny, you'd get a very good chance of playing a part or submitting a song for it. They couldn't use the real songs apparently.
Right.
They wanted some songs. sounded a bit like Fleetwood Mac. So we did a couple, and anyway, we didn't get, I don't think the movie ended
up. It didn't happen.
Yeah.
And then when it came to the Spirit album, we started, we
resurrected it, didn't we? And changed it, you know,
right.
Took it away from
yeah.
That.
And it's not a normal vibe, that song, is it? Because it's sort of
I think so. I don't know. I think so.
We've got so many vibes, haven't we?
Yeah,
you do.
We can go into country a little bit.
Yeah, but we're a blues country soul prog rock.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Actually, add rap to that, because I played guitar for Naughty by Nature back in 1994.
Mm-hmm.
Dear, oh dear. Anyway, but yeah, so that's
another great song.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fly, another favorite of mine from Spirit. I guess I like that Spirit album. you know, I'm going to go way back now to 1985. Hungry Night.
Ah, For You in the Moon. Hungry Night is a good song, though.
Deborah, that should have been a hit in that time. You know that?
Well, it all, you know, that's what sort of happened throughout my early career.
Right.
That it was either the wrong record company or that people screwed things up, and it just sort of, you know, things never quite got to where they should have. But, you know, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, and I think if things had have worked out back then, I'm not sure I would have been here now, because, you know, I probably would have ended up going a bit crazy. So I think it just made me a lot stronger that we just kept going and kept going. And, you know, that's something that has been said before, when some people have said, you know, why wasn't that a hit?
Exactly.
Why hasn't that been a hit? Why haven't we heard of you? Why haven't, you know, and all of this? But sometimes it goes that way, you know, and it's all about having the right people on board. It's not just about us and the music. It's about having the right people to get it to where it needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully with QBR and certainly with Gary Nesbitt, you know, I think this time we've got really good people on our side. So we're hoping that will, you know, help with this album.
You know, people think that you're a shoo-in just because, you know, your big brother was, you know, he's got the bottom name, and of course Jason and this and that. It's not true. I've talked to a lot of musicians with their children, and they have a harder time breaking in than their fathers and mothers, you know, do, you know?
Well, I agree. I think, I mean, it was just something from years ago. I could have changed my name, but it would have always have come out.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is, I just thought, well, you know, if I'm going to try in this business that my brother became so famous in,
sure,
I've just got to keep at it. I've got to know that this, I've got to be good, and I've got to stick at it.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah, no, it's not easy, but it's also been a different time as well from the 70s.
It is.
It's not that I'm saying it's not as easy, but things are very different now, you know, with album sales and then you've got the Spotify's and all of this. I mean, it's a complete different,
it is,
different thing now. It's much, much, much tougher to make it as a paid musician in
exactly.
This world now.
Yeah.
But, you know, we keep going. We've done well, and I'm proud of that. And you know, long may it keep going.
Another album I like, Strange Angels in Flight, you know, the Elmore James deal.
Yeah, yeah.
That was great. I mean, Dust My Broom, you guys did a wonderful job on that.
Well, that, Marco Giovino is on this album as well, the new album.
Yeah.
And,
he produced Strange Angels.
He produced Strange, yeah, he did. And, of course, I met him through Robert, because he was in Band of Joy. So, yeah, we're all sort of connected somewhere. Each album's connected, and I'm still with all the same players, you know, from way back. You know, my bass player is from 30 years ago as well, and keyboard players, and then we have guest players come in as well. And, yeah.
We do get a lot of people seem to ask if they can play with us. After the American tour that we did with Ann Wilson of Heart and Jeff Beck and Paul Rogers.
Yeah.
We got along so well with the Heart Boys and all that kind of stuff that whenever it came to of the album. They were all calling, can we do a track? Can we play on a track? And I said, so we've given Andy, the bass player, a track.
You didn't bring them up and beg them, and they said, how much are you going to pay?
No, that Andy was falling around like a lost puppy, he was. So Andy Stoller, if you're listening, he's a little lost puppy.
We love Andy.
He did his little puppy eyes, please, please, can't play.
They were, honestly, that tour was fantastic. Yeah. They were such lovely guys. So it was an honour to have him on the album, you know. So, yeah. So it's been great.
It's nice to have a lot of friends in the business, you know. You can just call them up and, you know, come play on my track.
It was a bit like that. You know?
Yeah.
So, what are you doing? Do you fancy playing on a track?
Exactly.
So, but it's great. That's been the great thing about all the people you meet as you carry on along this business.
We've got a huge amount of guests on this album.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
A huge amount, but just a lot of people that we've always wanted to play with.
Sure.
That we've known for years, and we've never had the opportunity to play with them. It was, it's great.
You've done Zeppelin covers, you've done Bad Company covers, but my favorite Zeppelin cover you've done is Since I've Been Loving You. That's amazing. You did a great job on that.
Oh, well, that was unrehearsed. I didn't even really...
I loved it.
I flew over to L.A. because my sister-in-law, John's wife, Pat,
right,
daughter Zoe, were going to this, you know, it was a memorial for John, a concert.
Night for Bonzo,
wasn't it? That was it.
Drummer called Brian Titchy puts it on.
And they wanted me to go over, and so I did. So I didn't know I was going to sing, and then when I was there, so he said to me, well, why don't you see if you want to do a number with Brian? And then they said, oh yeah, come and get up and do a number. And then it was like, Since I've Been Loving You.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was no rehearsal for that. I knew the song though.
Oh, it was wonderful.
There was a rehearsal at Soundcheck. You got to do it once.
Oh, we did. In Soundcheck with Chad.
Yeah. From the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
On drums, yeah. So that was, I don't tend to do Led Zeppelin. So I do, we play rock and roll at the end of the show. If it's a big show and the audience have been with us with all of our music, then yeah, of course, you know, but...
This was a one-off, really,
and it was very emotional and fantastic. Oh, and I did Battle of Evermore with Jason at Rockline Radio.
I did hear that one.
Rehearsal.
I liked that one.
I didn't even know he was going to sing.
Yeah.
And then I thought that his singer was singing it with me, and then it was Jason. I thought, hold on a minute, Jason, the drummer. What are you doing? But he sings great, you know. And he knew which harmony to go for, and I knew which one to do, and all of a sudden there we were singing it.
And apparently your brother, Jason's dad, was a great singer as well.
Yeah, he was. Mm.
That's the first time I heard Jason sing. On that song. That's the first time I heard Jason sing on the Battle of Evermore. Yeah.
We then did a duet together on his album, Turning Back the Time, wasn't it?
On his When You See the Sun album.
Jason said to me, come and sing this with me, so we did a duet then. But he's got a great voice, Jace.
Yeah, he's really surprised me.
Not half as much as he surprised me in front of 3 million listeners. I was absolutely in a terrible state.
Yeah.
I said, oh my God, no rehearsal, and here we go. Oh, but it turned out brilliantly.
What one of my listeners, Mark, his name is Mark, asked me if, could you tell, what are the differences between playing between John and Jason? Could you see different styles there? Any different styles or?
Well, obviously Jason's got his dad's style. He's grown up with it, and
right.
You know, he's got his dad's soul when he plays. But Jason's got his own style as well. And I hear a bit of Phil Collins in him almost. But
really?
Jason's very much got his own style. The common denominator for Jason is his dad's playing. I mean, you can hear that he's John Bonham's son, but mm-hmm. he certainly made his own style. John's style was just one of a kind, you know.
John was of those British drummers that had taken the swing and the jazz and then playing in a rock and blues
right.
thing.
Right.
I mean, John grew up listening to Gene Krupa and Buddy Rich
and the Motown
drummers, so he was very much all about that.
Yeah.
And Jason's listened to a lot of that as well, but of course, he from the age of, I don't know, three, jumping on a drum kit, so mm-hmm. of course he's got his dad's sound about him, but he's got his own thing. He's not a carbon copy of his dad. Jason's really developed his own style and a fantastic drummer.
He's got more modern influences, which you can't help. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jason's got very popular. He really got popular out there.
Sorry, my phone is now starting to cut out.
Oh, okay.
I
was saying Jason got very, very popular out there.
Oh yeah. I think he's one of the world's greatest drummers now. You know, he's a phenomenal drummer, Jason. I think his dad will be very, very proud.
Okay, Deborah and Peter, here's your final question. I ask everybody this question, and I get some very interesting answers. If you had a Field of Dreams wish, you know, like the movie, to perform or collaborate with anyone from the past or present, who would that be?
Well, of course it's going to be John for me. You know? Of course, I'd love John to be in the band, and I think Paul Kossoff.
Right.
Well,
I don't know, he'd show me up, wouldn't he?
This is my band, I was going to say. You're not in it. I don't know. For me, definitely John would need to be in the band, so I'll let Pete pick the guitarist.
Oh, Christ. For you or for me?
I don't know.
Well,
what singer do you want?
Actually, I've done it. It's Paul Rodgers, isn't it?
He's not from the pop.
No, he said he'd be from the past or present.
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, yeah. He's already done
that. He's my favourite singer, so that's a bit of luck, isn't it?
And Robert Plant's my favourite.
Well, there you go. You've already done it.
I'd have Felipe Wynn. I love Felipe Wynn of the Spinners. His voice for me is mm-hmm. phenomenal. And I'd have to have Eddie Van Halen on guitar.
There you go.
I would. I had the absolute joy of playing with Eddie and Van Halen.
Mm-hmm.
We did rock and roll, actually.
Oh, great. That's awesome.
Just the rock and roll. And apparently I'm the only person who didn't let Eddie do a solo, and he was on his knees in front of me begging me to do a solo. And all I could see was Eddie Van Halen, this guy that I had a poster on the wall, you know, throwing up. And every time I looked down and saw him, I just blushed and carried on singing another verse.
That's funny.
It wasn't until the song ended that he did a solo.
That's funny.
Lovely, lovely guy. So yeah, I'd have to have him on guitar.
I asked Robin Trower, and he surprised me. I would have said, I asked Robin Trower, and he said James Brown, which surprised me. I said, what about Jimi Hendrix? He said, no, I can't play with Jimi Hendrix. He'd show me up.
James Brown, yeah. I mean, gosh, I wouldn't be able to keep up with those moves. Yeah. In fact, Chadwick Boseman, have you seen that film that he's done?
Yeah, he did a great job, didn't he? Yeah.
Amazing. Totally amazing.
He did a wonderful, wonderful job. It's a shame he passed away, too.
Oh, I was absolutely gutted when I saw that.
Yeah.
What a lovely guy and such a talent and so young.
Very talented. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Deborah, Pete, I want to thank you so much for being on the show today. It's been wonderful. It's been entertaining.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having us, Ray.
Thank you, Ray.
I can listen to you guys all day. I want to say good luck with the new album. We'll get you on again after the album's released, and then we can, after I hear it and everything, then we can talk a little bit more about it, I guess.
Yeah, and thanks to all your listeners and tuning in. We hope to see you over there sometime.
I hope so. Wait, well, we got Rick Wills here, and we got Brian Johnson from AC/DC, and we got Rick Derringer. They're all within like 20 minutes from me, so.
Well, Pete has done a gig with Brian. We were with Brian on the Paul Rogers tour. Pete had the absolute joy of being on stage with Paul Rogers, Brian Johnson.
Wow. That's incredible. That's incredible.
I think that's his Pete's dream band.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I did that.
You've
yeah,
got your,
cool, isn't it? Oh, yeah, yeah.
Got your dream band, haven't you?
the song we did was Money, which starts off with, I think Paul Rogers chose it deliberately as a bit of cheek, because the first line of it is, the best things in life are free.
Yeah, well, there you go, free. Oh, they were just so cool.
That's great. Man, would that be on YouTube by any chance, or no?
Could you say again, Ray, the battery on the phone isn't it? We've been talking for long. It's gone.
Would that be on YouTube, you think, that show?
It is, yeah.
Okay.
All the links on the email, Ray.
I'll look it up, and I'll put it on my site as well.
It's hilarious. You can see it was a complete... They turned up, Brian Johnson and Robert Plant turned up in the afternoon at our show in Oxford.
That's incredible.
They've been filming for one. And it was an off-the-cuff thing. It's, Brian hadn't sung in a long time because of his ears.
Right.
But now we persuaded them to get up and sing. It's hilarious.
Yeah. And they got a new album out, and they're going to probably go on tour again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was serious, wasn't it?
Yeah. Deborah and Pete, thank you so much again. And, you know, you guys are wonderful. Keep up doing what you're doing. Good luck with the new album. And please come to Florida.
Thank you so much. Back at you.
Thanks so much, Ray.
Thank you. Cheers.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now. For more information about Deborah Bonham, visit www.deborahbonham.com. That's the official website. Also on Facebook, www.facebook.com/Deborah Bonham Official. She's also on Twitter, twitter.com/Deborah Bonham. And you can also visit Quarto Valley Records at www.quartovalleyrecords.com. Very special thanks to Gary Nesbitt for arranging this interview with Deborah Bonham and Peter Bullock. And, of course, the dynamic duo of Doug and Don Newsome of BBS Radio for making the magic happen for each and every broadcast of interviewing the legends. We are going on our fifth year now. If you have comments or suggestions for the show, you can always contact me at interviewingthelegends@gmail.com. And please subscribe to my YouTube channel, Interviewing the Legends with Ray Shasho, for the very latest interviews directly into your email box. It's also real news. My new book is finally out. It's entitled The Rockstar Chronicles, Series 1. It chronicles truths, confessions, and wisdom from the music legends that set us free. Order yours today on hardcover or ebook, and it's available at bookbaby.com. It features over 45 intimate conversations with some of the greatest rock legends the world will ever know. Thank you for listening. We appreciate it. And keep on rocking. That's the main thing. Let's keep rock and roll alive. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you, everybody, for listening to Interviewing the Legends. Brought to you by the Publicity Works Agency. Call 941-877-1552 or visit us at publicityworksagency.com. Specializing in author and music artist publicity plans. We shine when we make you shine. Tune in to Interviewing the Legends every Tuesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Time on BBS Radio, Station 1.